Which is where? Chapter.
No, it's a few lines into page Mosaic. I smacked it. It's like seven lines into. Six lines. But I'm against what keshurin. Okay, now we're going to find a distinction. We said that the oir hamemalek olam is also miyuchad, is one with the oir inside. We used various type of explanations and mishalim to give us a sense of how this is still. What does it mean it's part of? Because it's actually rooted in the truth of the Seiv of Kolam. And then it comes forth in an expressed form which is called the Lamed Beis Nesivos Chochma, in a normal fashion, even though they are separate strands of knowledge, but they're really one and connected to the garment itself, to the cervical garment, and they're made of the same, so to speak, the same material, of the same primary reality. Because, okay, that will be sufficient for this. So this is what the Rebbe said to explain in terms of the relationship of Mamalek Olam and Sefer Kolam. Mamalek Olam is included and is drawn from Sefer Kolam, but not Sefer Kolam after he becomes a world service, so to speak. But Sefer Kolam, as it is within the Bli Gvul, and within that Sefer Kolam, there is also the included in Mamalek Olam. And now in parentheses, V'hainu, which means to say, She'ein Zeh. Okay, I just want to remind ourselves a point that we learned way back when. Discuss it very back in one. Originally, the Rebbe asked a question: what is the effect of tzimtzum on oir? If you recall that discussion, and the principle in that discussion is this: oir is always representative of its source. Oil never becomes an entity unto itself. Therefore, how does tzimtzum affect oil? It seems it remains oil even after the tzimtzum. This is what we have now come to conclude, that yes, indeed, there is a tzimtzum, and this draws in from Mamalek Olam, and it comes in the form of Lamed Beis Nesivos Chochma, pathways of Chochma, and Chochma is completely united with its source and bottle, and yet there's a tzimtzum. It's not the same. It's chokhmah. It's a revelation from the Ayin HaSof, but not the Ayin HaSof itself. As chokhmah is understood, this is the 32 pathways, which means there is a different recognition within chokhmah. Just like the motion for this is like the strands of tzitzis. They are made of the same material as the garment, and they're fully attached to the garment, and yet they're separate. And what, we spoke about this, what alerts you to the fact that they're separate? It is the fact that they can be attached and disattached. And this is the union that you have appointed in the Chochmah. And the Chochmah, Chochmah is a straight flow, but you have to allow it to come. And it's possible to distract yourself and not know it. And the motion for this, and the simple motion for this, is in sight. Sight, likewise, has this phenomenal simplicity. That you see things as they are unto themselves. Not as they affect you, which is a phenomenal thing. And yet it is your experience, because it's possible for you to close your eyes and not see. And you see because you want to see. You allow yourself to see. There is still a true experience in that sight. Although what you're seeing is the reality itself.
But Paltiel, about detaching and attaching, and not closing eyes and not. I don't understand how it's detaching and not detaching and attaching. You can be oblivious to it, but it itself is always attached. What does it mean, detached?
You mean, see, the koyach ha-chokhmah in the nefesh, is that what you mean to say?
Yeah, you're saying that this there's a tzimtzum from this that it can be detached, you can detach it and attach. You could be oblivious to it, but what does it mean?
No, I'm sorry. If you're... we are using chokhmah as a muscle for this union to enable us to understand it. Within our capacity, within our experience of Chochmah, we have the sinyan that you can attach and disattach. What does this say? Even though, see, this is the oddity of it. But when you see it, you see the reality itself. If you say that you see it from as an outsider, how can you see the reality itself? There has to be something that makes you see it. And yet, that's not the case. You see the reality itself. The fact that there is an outsider element, in fact, that you can not, you can turn away or not see it. You're not, it's not a forced union, it's not a must. That means that your connection to it is an effective connection, not a unit of a connection. The same is true on the higher koichas, even in the koichas and nefesh itself. This is what we've been saying, that in the nefesh there is orotzen and noinik, which is always one thing with the nefesh. Then there's seichel. Seichel is also a nefesh quality, and it gives you the truth of the nefesh, but it is capable of being understood from the outside. And that makes it, that gives it an element of a presence.
Individuality.
Of a presence. Although, again, this is important to understand, you what you know is the truth itself, not as you experience it. Behainu, okay.
That was just to see if I followed this, and that was to describe how tzimtzum, yes, does in fact affect
right.
Or, right?
Right. Although it remains oir,
yeah.
And yet there's an effect of tzimtzum. Behainu, okay, in parameters now. This is for further clarity. Behainu, this means to say, she'ein zeh, that this and the tzeiros of chokhma of the oir hamemalik is not k'moy shoroshe hakeli, and not of the same caliber, of the same stance as shoroshe hakeilim, as the roots of the keli. Haklolim be'er insoy, the keilim are also kolod ne'er insoy, which we will have to discuss a little bit, maybe a lot. But the point is, the keilim are also kolod ne'er insoy. Which, as I said, we'll see a little later what this implies and how this is true. And in the scholars of the Kelim in Ayin Sof, Dim Heyois, that over old up, he began in Kelim, Shezehu Gam Kein Ayin Sof Mamosh. Even though that the end of the Kelim is also in Sof, Mamosh, truly in Sof. Nonetheless, Harei heim bechinas oisiyus levad. But nonetheless, what is kelim? Bechinas, the bechina of the oisiyus, of just the oisiyus levad. Avol but shoroshe hoirois. But the roots of the oirois, harei heim bechinas oirois. Okay. So now we come to a need to clearly distinguish between the oisiyus, and even though the oisiyus are also rooted in the insof, and it's insof mamash, but oisiyus are not oiris. Oiris, in Shiroshi Hoiris, this is Bechinas Oiris. We will try to discuss it and to put it in some kind of a understanding and some perspective. This means oisiyus levad, and how oisiyus are in soif mamash, and then we're saying that the oireis are in a different category. Try to get into this. I hope I don't lose you. I hope you don't lose yourself. I hope we stay on track. We are trying to explain the following: that there is such thing as oir and keli. Oir and keli are distinguishable from the following perspective. Oir cannot be taken distinct, separate from this, from its source. Keli can be taken separate from its source. That's what a keli is about. both oil and keli are rooted and included in the oil, in the insight, in the very source of everything. And in the source, they are one with the source itself. Within that source, there's a difference between the way Kelim are one with the source and the way Oilas are one with the source. Where the Kelim, as the young one with the source, as he says, are Oisis Levad, are just Oisis. Whereas the oilers within the adherence of are oilers.
Didn't get this last statement.
And you didn't get it.
No, this
I'm amazed statement. That you didn't get it.
No, just what?
Yeah.
It seems a circular sentence. The oilers are just oilers. What happened there?
No. Oisiers are just oisiers.
Yeah.
That's left. Okay, now you have to apply your thought. Ois is levad. Whereas by oinois, they are bechinas oinois. What do you remember our discussion of oinois?
Well, we brought out that their main feature is that they're never separated.
No. Just we said now.
Yeah.
Throughout our discussion, this is not the first time we talk about oinois. What do you remember about explanation about oinois are?
Representative of essence.
Representative of essence? Are Kelim, Oishi a representative of essence? See, this is why I'm almost afraid to go. We must retain all our experience in order to understand, to go further.
Rabbi, before...
No,
the
one second. What is it?
We just said that the oil represents the source, always.
Okay. The best way that I can have us kind of relate to what is being discussed, and once it's presented on that level, then we have to be able to project how it is on a higher level. But on the lowest level, it's as follows, as we mentioned many times. It's a phenomenal principle. We said many times that a table is an element that is drawn from the nefesh order. It represents, so to speak, human dignity, not comfort, not utility, but really something exclusively human. Nefesh, a living nefesh. Now then, when you actually go and sit at a table, at a physical table, this physical table is a separate entity from the nefesh. It's made of wood and a structure. And you're only sitting by it. It's completely a separate thing. It was made by a carpenter, as a matter of fact. Yet, I said, there's an interesting phenomenon about this. Because this is representative of a human quality. And the original thought of it is actually drawn from, as you said, from a deep and true human element. Therefore, as you were sitting at the table and you're using it, you're not sensing that you're using something extraneous. You're perfectly well oriented with it, united with it. This union, I'll give you, we'll take this table example and compare it to a tool, a screwdriver, a hammer, a saw, which is also a keli that the person uses to accomplish certain tasks. And some people are very adept at it. An experienced carpenter with a hammer in his hand, do you think that he is as much united with the hammer as when you're sitting at the table?
Different way. Different kind of unity.
It's very different, right? It's very different. A human being must have a table in his home. A carpenter must not have a hammer in his house. When he has to do something, he has to get a hammer. But it doesn't represent him to the extent that there must be a hammer in his home. So here we have two elements, both are on the keli level, but one is a keli that is united and sourced in the human being. And one is not sourced in the human being. He learns to use it for a certain circumstantial need. The union of keli, which means the union that that the human quality in our motion can be represented and contained and in a worldly context, is it called the keli? This is rooted in the nefesh itself. And the reason for that is because the human being came to the world for the purpose of being involved in the world and bringing his quality to the world. He's not a stranger in the world. You follow what I'm saying?
Otherwise you would think he would feel like he's a stranger.
That's right. Pruvu milu zotz v'chiv shur. He's not a stranger. That is his initial creation. This union that a human being has an effect on the world is part of the plan of his creation. Not an afterthought. And therefore, the means by which he is represented in the world is rooted in the human being himself. A table is representative of the human being. A home is representative of the human being, as we say all the time. So kelim are also rooted in the essence. But then there is also oirois rooted in the essence. And this is what the Rebbe is saying. We have to distinguish between the way kelim are rooted in the essence and the way oirois are rooted in the essence.
It's enough for me to.
You have plenty to think about, right?
Yeah.
Okay, this is what I'm saying. The oiris are oiris. Kelim are oisis levat. Oiris means. Okay, if I would put it in words. Oiris don't exist without the source. Kelim do.
They do not originate without a source, but they exist without a source.
They originate in the source to be kelim. He said, the human being, in the original aspect in the human being, that he has to be effective in the world. That's to be Caleb. This is not him. Seichel is him. As we learned way back when, word from Mimer, exactly as I'm quoting it, a Seichel, the Heinen Ishmos. Okay. That cannot be said about Cain. Although they are also rooted in insight. This is why this looks seems like circular logic. But the oiris are oiris. The Cainim are Cainim. Because the Rebbe is taking for granted that you are thinking along with him. You're not waiting for him to put it in other words. When you say the word kelim, it means something to you. When you say oiris, it means something to you. Okay. So Rosh Hashanah, Hareihem, I'm reading the words inside. Bechinas Oiris. What does Bechinas Oiris mean? So Rosh Hashanah are Oiris. Saying Bechinas Oiris. What is the Bechina of Oiris? There is two aspects in Oiris. There is the effect of the Oir. And there is what it is unto itself. Bechina Soiris is that it is not an entity unto itself. No matter what its effect is, it is not an entity unto itself. So that, taking this in our mashal, if a human being is present in a home or in a room, he's effective, he is present there. But what's present? His presence or him? It's one with him. Like what Rabbi Yechon and Zachi says, that when a person, He wants Mishu that no human being will see him. Not because he's concerned that what the human being is gonna do about it. He's not gonna do anything. It has nothing to do with him.
Who doesn't want the people to see him?
If a person does something wrong.
Oh. Right.
Nishalayaraniodum is just that the person shouldn't see him, not because not
right.
There should not be fallout from the fact that he's seen. And there's not going to be fallout. Any follow up? A total stranger who doesn't know who I am. I still don't want him to see. But not because there's going to be any kind of follow up. Because there's a certain reality about the presence of a human being. And that stays with that, it's there. It's called the oyer. Okay. This is it for this morning.